The Great Fifth soon entered into an agreement with the new Pan-Asian emperors of the era, the Manchus, to guarantee Tibetan independence and national integrity. The Manchus were a Tungusic people from the forest north of Korea who conquered northern China in 1644. Due to His Holiness the Dalai Lama's, Great Fifth Dalai Lama's authority over the fearsome Mongolians, the Dalai Lama was seen as a potent ally by the new Manchu emperor. And the Manchu emperor in the sense of secular and the Dalai Lama in the sense of sacred, they had a perfect match. In 1651, a unique alliance was formed between the Manchu Shunzhi emperor and the Great Fifth. The Manchus recognized the Dalai Lama's secular authority over Tibet as well as his spiritual authority over the whole world of Asia as they knew it. The Dalai Lama agreed to encourage the Mongolians, the one people the Manchus feared militarily, to practice Buddhism and diminish their militarism. And the Manchus agreed to protect the peace within Mongolia and Tibet for the demilitarizing and demilitarized Buddhist societies. The Tibetan pacification of the Mongols, the demilitarization of that most militarily powerful society, with the patronage of the Manchurians, is one of the remarkable social transformations in history. In the 317 years of the Dalai Lama's uninterrupted rule over Tibet, a remarkable society was developed. It was completely demilitarized and was utterly educationalized in that the monastic vocation, which was a vocation in a monastic university, mind you, not just a praying monastery, but an educating monastery, spiritually educating monastery, was thriving at the highest rate it ever achieved in any society anywhere. There is no space here to describe the sort of totally educationalized and monastically educationalized, lifelong educationalized society in detail. And by saying it was this sort of amazing educationalized thing, no one is saying that it was Shangri-La, that everything was perfect. The Tibetans themselves believe that Shambhala, which is the model for the Shangri-La, Western Shangri-La fantasy, exists in the North Pole region, and Tibetans have a fantasy about themselves, highly aware of the all too human faults of their land of snows. But it still was perceived by Tibetans as what they call a central land, in the sense of a central place where the Buddha Dharma could be the life purpose of any being who really wanted it to be. That made it a central land, as ancient India had been the central land. So it was perceived as a central land blessed by the presidency of Lokeshvara, the Messiah figure believed in by the vast majority of Mahayana Buddhists. It was sort of like your Jesus had come back and there he was, and he was in the White House, if you want to put it in American terms. You don't have to wait for him and for some terrible rapture for something to happen. He's right there. So then that puts the pressure on you to really put into practice the teaching and not just expect him to take care of you. You have to do it type of thing. You know, it's that kind of a culture, what I call the millennial conscience culture. It was the land of the sacred mantra, Om Mani Padme Hum, come, jewel and lotus holder, O savior Lokeshvara, be in my heart. It was, which is what that mantra means, although they just say it, Om Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, Mani Padme Hum, like that. It was therefore a place of unprecedented opportunity for the individual intent on enlightenment. Maximum low-cost, lifelong educational opportunity, minimum taxes, no military service, no mortgages, no factories of material products, no lack of teachings and realized beings, and even the opportunity to develop the ability to take rebirth, to continue in your next life, in the womb, what I call make a successful womb shot, like a moonshot, you know, womb shot, hometown, region, class of one's choosing, and then to return to one's favorite retreat cave, monastery, or retreat villa. But just lest you think that everyone in Tibet was living in some perfect serenity, let me just tell you an anecdote that the present Dalai Lama in the present time teaches Tibetans, when he gives teachings to Tibetans or meets them in some any kind of form by media in central Tibet, in the homeland, and in exile in person, he always likes to tell them, now, I'm happy that you all like to say Om Mani Padme Hum, but remember, don't make that, turn that into Om Mani Padme Hum. He says, don't say it like that. It's Om Mani Padme Hum, not Om Mani Padme Hum. So he's right there. That's the earthy nature of the Tibetans. They are just normal earthy people. But the social structure that they created in their culture was unique in the way I've said. And people should not make that into me my trying to claim that somehow the place was Shangri-La, because I and they are highly aware that it was not.